the techniques of submission, obedience, of, you know, keeping a hierarchy in place. They never learned it. So today they are in a lucky situation due to poverty and scarcity and geopolitical marginal position. They are now in the lucky position that they have not to unlearn it again. Because, you know, all of us, we have learned, we are socialized into behaving in these ranked worthiness systems, and they never learned that, so they don't have to unlearn it now. When the human rights revolution comes, or the human rights values come, they are coinciding with traditional Norwegian cultural values. So when I come to Norway, and this is one reason why I spend 2 months per year in Norway, because in Norway I do not have to explain the notion of equality. It's in the bodies, in the souls of everybody. Don't have to explain it. Especially as a woman, for me, it's a big difference. I say I need 2 months per year in Norway just to get the strength to go out into the world again. So it's a kind of a historical accident that gave them this cultural heritage, and they have even one word for it. You know, in English we have equality and dignity. It's three words. In Norwegian we have one word for it, likeverd. One word for what we need, three words in English. Gleiche Menschenwürde in German, heavy words, you know. Egalité en dignité. You know, you always have difficulties to express it. You don't have one word, but in Norway you have one word, likeverd. So so there it is by accident, Norway has been spared, and already Sweden is different. Not the entire Scandinavia. Sweden is already much more hierarchical past, but Norway is accepted, and therefore it has today this very, very, very interesting cultural heritage of likeverd.
And that's one of the reasons why ABBA should certainly add Norway to its cultural and educational program. We should add Norway, shouldn't we? All in favor? Okay.
Are there more points? You look skeptical, but willing to follow on with me.
It's okay. Yeah, I mean, I knew that, I mean, but it's important to share this feeling.
Thank you.
Questions, queries, contributions?
It's funny because Norway has a king. Mm-hmm. It will be a kind of inherited.
Yes.
But it works anyway.
Yes, it's exactly what we were talking before about the pilots. Mm-hmm. And the king in Norway is like the father of the current king, who was very much loved. He would take the public transport to go up the hill and go skiing. Mm-hmm. And he would pay, you know, the driver of the tram would want him to not pay the king, but the king insisted he needed to pay. So the king just went with his dog on the public transport to the mountain and he went skiing. Mm-hmm. So, and you would, you know, when you were in Norway, you would see that there are no barriers, and therefore this recent attack by this Anders Behring Breivik was so shocking, because there are no barriers. You know, the government quarters were not protected, so this man there would go with his explosives in the middle of the government and blow it up, because Norway was so used to not having people from outside coming or from, you know, disturbing this kind of cohesion and equality.
Your experience in looking into that.
Two guineas.
I thought okay. Só não tem uma experiência de escassez no Japão. E no Japão você tem uma hierarquia para falar, mas o respeito a gente percebe. Não falar, a gente percebe o respeito. Isso talvez ela recebeu algum apoio nesse sentido. Obrigada.
So it's my experience in Japan.
Yes.
And when there, the hierarchy is even embedded into linguistics.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Into interactions and even the language, you know. There is no way to speak without referring to the hierarchy. Respect for the hierarchy is embedded into the words. Like this is what also makes English easy to speak, because you can simply say you and I. In Japan, you couldn't say that. And in French and German, you cannot say that. You have already decide whether you say sie or du or vous or tu. Already in French and German, you have that you cannot simply go and say you. You have to decide, do I say sie or vous, which puts you up, the other up, or are we on the same level? Then we can say du and tu. And so it makes it very complicated. You can almost, you know, many people try to avoid it and make indirect sentences. It's very complicated. In Japan, one cannot escape. One is caught in a language that one cannot escape of hierarchy. Yes. So therefore, I'm glad that I'm not born as a Japanese, in a Japanese family, because it's so difficult to get out of this. And I have so many Japanese friends, especially women, who learn English in order to get out of it. And they want to have a husband from outside of Japan to get out of
it. Yeah. Just about language, just for curiosity, how many languages can you speak?
I think that these are good questions, because these are leading to this kind of flow of life. My aim was to acquire a gut feeling of all the five or six families of languages that we have on our planet, so that I can feel how does it feel to be born into Chinese? How does it feel to be born into Arabic? How does it feel to be born in comparison to I was born into our the language, the writing we use here? So how does it feel? So this was my kind of ambition. So I started doing that already in school. I had English, French, German, and Russian as languages. And so the best language, the languages I speak best is now English, French, German, and Norwegian. And then, you know, if you would count them, about 12 languages, but you cannot count them. Because I would say in Europe you have only two languages. You have the Germanic languages, you have the Latin languages, and English is a mixture.
Mm-hmm.
So I would not count the Portuguese, Spanish, French, Italian as separate languages. For me it's one language, and German, Dutch, Norwegian, Swedish, and Danish is one language to me. And then there are some outliers like Finnish and Hungarian, Basque, and all these are different. So counting wouldn't be a good idea, I think. So what is the experience when you are born into a Chinese context as compared, for example, to an Arabic context? I lived 7 years in Egypt, and I learned how to write Arabic in about 3 hours. I spent a lot of time in China, and I started studying Chinese script when I was 19, and it's a lifelong task. We never finish. Arabic, you learn it in several hours. So what the difference, you know? And then you learn, when you learn to write Chinese, you learn a philosophy. You are kind of like in Japan, you are forced into a system via language. And in China, you are forced into philosophy, a Confucian philosophy, originally in a way, through the script. And in the Arab world, you're not. You have a very phonetic script. So when you try to learn the Arab language, it takes a lifetime. You know, I used to live in Egypt, I learned Egyptian. the language is not Slavic. So, so you see these different ways of people growing up, being forced into systems, and looking at the world from that perspective. So this is the long description, you know, this explanation of the short issue.
Have you managed to get along with 5 minutes?
Yes. But it, you know, so the result in my head is when I speak now, I don't have one language to come from. I have a mixture, a salad of languages and words in my head for every sentence I say now. I have to translate it into one language wherever I am. So, you know, people say, but what is your mother tongue? I have no mother tongue. There's no default language in my head. And so I don't speak any language perfect. I speak many languages imperfectly. So not a single language is perfect, but all is mixed. And I always have to make a big effort to get into one language out of that salad.
Now I understand why you were born citizen. You're too big to fit in one country. Talking about air in awesome languages, you mentioned vous in French and sie in German as respectful and so in English only you. But I know that in Norwegian they used to have de and du.
Yeah.
Du. Yeah, and then the is more like for formal, yeah. But it seems that they don't use more anymore, just for the king. Are there any other situation that can use the unless I mean?
Yes, it's in flux. It's in flux.
Uh-huh.
Like 10 years ago, 20 years ago, it would be more.
Okay.
Some people, older people, would still use the more formal way,
mm-hmm.
but it's getting less and less and less.
But sometimes
and basically, if you look at the U in English, it's Z.
Yeah,
it's
that's right. That's right.
So in Norway, it's the du means really it's the non-formal way. There is basically no non-formal way. The informal way, yeah. And in Norway, people would address each other in the informal family way. Except the king, You can say, you king, what does the king think about ABC? Would a journalist ask. But already the prime minister would be asked, yes, what do you think, yes?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, look, that is the thing.
Could you tell them a little bit about what you'll be doing in Hapa?
Oh, yes.
Why,
yes, you said that. Yeah. Somehow, second part of June, I had two invitations, one to Rio plus 20 and one to Maraba. And I chose Maraba. Why? Because, you know, in Rio, any other generation before, we have a window of opportunity of 50 to maximum 100 years to make this transition in a good way. So you who are sitting here, you have the responsibility to do this transition. And nobody ever before has had as much responsibility as you who are sitting here. And if we think about how we want to shape this future for our human family, then we have to go, it's a good idea to go back to here and ask ourselves, how was our first adaptation as a human family when we for the first time met the fact that something that we thought was limitless is limited? We adapted by intensification. Is that really the right way to intensify intensification? To maximize the exploitation of the resources of our planet? Is this really the best adaptation today still?
No.
Yes.
Right.
So we need to think through what, basically we could say here we have one set of conditions, then we start to meet the limits of our planet, and we tried to adapt as best as we could. And today, we meet the limits of this adaptation. We need to rethink. What wealthy we live here? What do we have? Kind of historical markers? Yes, we have. Like 1757 is the historical marker of this transition time we live in today. 1757, the meaning of the verb to humiliate changed. to humiliate for the first time in the Oxford Encyclopedia meant to violate the dignity of a person. It, for the first time, became antisocial to humiliate. Before, it was pro-social to humiliate. Like the father of the family had the duty, for example, to beat his disobedient wife and children. This was domestic chastisement, a duty. After 1757, it became domestic violence, a violation, from a duty to a violation. So you see, the verb to humiliate gives us a historical marker of a very important transition. And we are part of this transition. This transition has not finished. We are in the middle of it. Some people still believe that it's the duty of the man in the family to beat his children and wife. So some people are still, you could say, before that shift. I just saw a documentary of a wedding in Kazakhstan. The parents of the bride gave the groom a gift, a whip, so that he would whip his wife regularly so as to remind her of her due lowly place.
I'm sorry, when was that?
No.
Oh. Kazakhstan, yeah?
And here, you know, in every country, it's not just far away, we have it everywhere. I think you know in your neighborhood, you know very well that many people still think like that. In every country, there is no country on this world, on this planet, that is exempt. We are all in it as human family. So the next historical marker is 1948. There we have the Human Rights Declaration. All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. Oh yes, the time. How much is it? So I finish this sentence and then we have a break. Is that okay? So the next historical marker is 1948. We as a human family adopted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. And you know how this sentence read before? The past 10,000 years? The sentence read, all human beings are born unequal in worthiness. Some are born high, some are born low. And you all know people who still believe that today. You know, we were just discussing in the car, you know, why do we see all these high-rise buildings with the name Chateau de something, you know? Chateau Mouton. It's, you know, that some people believe, aha, there is high culture, French, you know, the court of Versailles, this is the last expression of really high aristocratic culture. So if we build a high-rise building here with the name Chateau de Mouton, we, you know, give the feeling to the people who live there that they are higher and worth more. Or you told me the example of the advertisement for Korean car, huh? Where it was, oh, this car is so good because you are higher up and you feel more better than the others, yeah.
The guy used to say that. He was in the car and he said, I like the car because I can see the car.
Right, yes. So you see, we are all socialized into that, all of us, and we don't really realize it. We are all, we have this value of equality and dignity, but it's really, really new. It has not yet permeated into our society. And not permeated even into our own psyche. I will make stop here.
Gostaria de lembrar que nós temos um livro que vocês vão assinar para que o certificado de participação seja conferido no fim. Não deixem de assinar o livro. Onde é que está o livro?
Aqui, ó. Eu gostaria de pedir meu passaporte. how it works? Should I do that now or at the end?
Yes.
In before the Second World War, there was a Broadway actor, Gary Davis. Second World War came, he was put on a plane to bomb Germany. After the Second World War, he was disgusted by being defined by national interest. In 1948, you find him in Paris when the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was adopted in Paris. You find him with Eleanor Roosevelt in Paris. You see a picture of 2,000 people there in the streets of Paris, and he says, "We just adopted the Human Rights Declaration where we say that all human beings are born free and equal in human rights." And he says, this sentence does not read all American beings are born free, or all French beings, or all whatever. It says all human beings. So he says, now, since we have adopted this declaration, the only legal instrument to be a human being and to define a human being and to make it legitimate is the world passport, a human passport. Because by being born a human being, you are legitimate. And so he said, I will now give away my American citizenship and I will adopt world citizenship. And I issue my passport, and everybody in the world is entitled to have this passport. The world passport is the only really legal instrument after this declaration has been adopted. All national passports are basically in violation of this sentence. At some point, in some way, this was his position. So he issued this passport, and you can go to his website, World Passport, and you can get this passport. You simply send an email there and you send your coordinates and you have to pay the postage, that's all. And you have the world passport. And he hopes that all the people in the world recognize that they must exercise the right to be human citizens, world citizens, by having the world passport. And he hopes that at some point all the people on this planet will go to the border of their countries only with the world passport, because then the authorities at the borders will have to change the nature of borders. And it would be a bottom-up movement. He uses this passport himself. Some countries accept it, and some countries accept it sometimes. You have the list on his website. You know, you can risk, if you, like he does, he wanted to participate in Oslo in 2008 in our conference there, and he had already given this passport to the King of Norway, but when he wanted to come to our conference, his world passport was rejected by Norway. So he made a press release, and he said, how come, and so. So this is Gary Davis's activism, is to travel everywhere and call on everybody to use this world passport. He's very angry with me when I don't use it, you know, to change the nation of borders, bottom up, and to express, to manifest our right to be human beings, to be world citizens. Yes?
Yeah,
yes,
my question.
Right, so many people who want to support his activism. He's now over 90 years old. He was the presidential candidate in the USA for 30 years ago, something. So many people want to support his campaign, and some really do only travel with a world passport, and they risk to be put on the plane and sent back when the country doesn't accept it. Others, they have their national passport and they give that first, and then they ask to get a stamp in the world passport. So people have kind of developed different ways of doing this activism of world citizenship with the passport. So I show it everywhere to make this idea known. And to show the power we as a human family have, you know. Simply getting this passport and everybody using it, the world will change, bottom up. So, 1948, the idea claimed that we are all born equal. The idea was adopted by the human family. And I have a graphical rendering of this. I want to make it clear graphically. When I respect myself so much, and I respect you the same, we are on one level. Is that clear? This is clear. Okay, so this, we could say, was the way we live together, more or less. It's idealized, of course. During the first 95% of our history, you know, in order to make clear that it was not paradise, it was not conflict-free, but it was, you know, dialogical. We can assume, like from archaeological evidence and anthropological evidence. Therefore, I put here the line A, the infinity symbol, the non-dualism symbol, the symbol for dialogue. So this might have been, if we conclude correctly, first 95% of our human history on this planet. Okay, what happened roughly 10,000 years ago? It started, the Neolithic Revolution started 10,000 years ago, but in southern Turkey and Iraq, today's Iraq, but it started independently in different parts of the world, and in some parts it started much, much later, like only 3,000 years ago. So it started 10,000 years ago, and then it started in other places, in one place and then in another place. So let's say what started, what did we as a human family do when we, for the first time, hit the fact that planet Earth is limited in size? What did we do? What did we do? What is the Neolithic revolution doing with us? Okay, we erected a gradient. Not everybody is the same anymore. Some people are high and some people are low. You see that? Some people are high, some people are low. And as I said, this was used as was regarded as divinely ordained as nature's order. Apartheid, in many, you know, apartheid was created because people believed that this was a good system. There is, in 700 after Christ, there are two kings in France. They are called the lazy kings, les rois fainéants. Why? Because they didn't do this holding down, keeping this hierarchy in place. They didn't do it. They wanted peace. They simply didn't do this. So they were toppled, and they were called the lazy kings. So as I said before, it was the duty of the father of the family to beat his disobedient wife and children. It was the duty of the masters to keep this in place. And to keep this in place, this hierarchy, you needed, and it was regarded as very useful, you needed humiliation because it kept this hierarchy in place. You needed even torture, you needed terror, you needed to terrorize your underlings in order to keep them in line. Was very, very accepted to have very, very cruel means of keeping this in line, but you could also have less cruel means like seating orders or kowtowing or the invention of the throne. We sit here on chairs because of that, because we usually sit on the floor, so we're sitting on the floor. The word chairman means that at some point one person was put on a higher surface, like a throne. You see that? So even the chairs that are in this room are a result of this. So what is the core of the human rights message, the human rights ideal? What is the core? Core is this, we dismantle this hierarchy. Basically, it's the U-turn, a normative ethical U-turn against what we did in the past 10,000 years. Like here we thought apartheid is legitimate. Here we think apartheid is not legitimate. Here we thought, like the dictators here in South America, they thought that it's legitimate to have a dictatorship. Here we think it's a crime. So you see this transition. This is the same transition that the word humiliate underwent in 1757. It's always a sort of transition from something that was seen as pro-social then, is now seen as anti-social. It's always the same transition. And it touches all segments of our lives. What does it mean to be a good wife? Here's many women. Here, good wife meant to be the servant, the obedient servant of your husband. Are you obedient servants of your husband?
So they would have to learn to feel human.
humiliate by being, you know, on a beach with a lifeless body. Learning to feel humiliated when conditions are humiliating, this is the motor of consensus as sound. So we need it. We need these feelings of humiliation. This is why I live globally, because I feel so personally humiliated by the conditions on this planet that I translate my feelings of humiliation into a very specific action. However, now comes the caveat. Do you remember the story of Rwanda? No. The Rwandan servants, the Hutus, were down for centuries. In 1957, the Hutu revolution, they came into power. They rose up. Okay? So you could say they rose up. What did they do? They did not stop here. They did not invite their former masters into a new future together. They went and killed them, tried to kill them all. My third book has a foreword by Desmond Tutu from South Africa. He writes that the South African white elite is very lucky. Why? Because Mandela would have had the power to go on radio, like in Rwanda, and tell all his black brothers and sisters, take your machetes that you have at home, go to your white neighbors and hack them to death. And they would have done it. Perhaps. So we see the power of humiliation, the force of humiliation, can be used for conscientization in Paulo Freire's way and invite everybody into a new future of equality and dignity. However, the same feelings instigated by humiliation entrepreneur can also lead to extreme violence. This is the force in feelings of humiliation. So you see, we live in a transition from this system, like where the wife must be beaten, and this system where the wife should not be beaten, from dualism to non-dualism, from a hierarchy to equality, from inequality in versus equality in versus. And all words like peace, reconciliation, conflict resolution, love, happiness, have a diametrically opposed meaning in these paradigms. Just imagine North Korea. North Korea now is like that. There is one dictator, and then there are many followers who are, you know, have to swallow humiliation quietly, you could say. What would the dictator of the leader of North Korea say to you? He would say, in North Korea we have peace. We don't need reconciliation because there is no conflict. And everybody loves me, and everybody is happy. So wherever you have a setup like that, you know, also the husband who thinks that beating his wife and children is legitimate, he would say the same to the social worker. He would say to the social worker, wait a minute, this is my home, and there's peace in my home. You know, beating my wife and children is part of peace, and there is no conflict, there is no need for anything. My wife loves me, my family is happy. And you, the social worker, by telling my wife that she is humiliated when I beat her, you are creating conflict. So you see, there is one set here where each word has a completely different meaning from what it has here. And you know, when we say here this hierarchy, what we might ask, during the past 10,000 years, we had these hierarchies in almost all societies on this planet. Brianna Eisler called it the dominator model of society. You know, the first 95% of our history seem to have lived in a more egalitarian context. Do we see remnants of that? here in the last 10,000 years? Yes, we do, because why is it, was it necessary always to force people down, force people into a hierarchy? And we see remnants, you see the founders of religions, very often started with a vision of equality and dignity. And since this is a Christian area here, Jesus went to people like prostitutes and other people that were down in society. And he went there, he stayed in their houses to show that they're equal. So he was kind of the first human rights activist in that way. And Sikh religion, Islam, many, many religious founders brought a vision of equal dignity first. But when then the church became institutionalized, then it became hierarchical. So you could say that we always observe a desire for equal diversity all the way through all the past 10,000 years. Then we have 1757, then we have 1948. And then after 1948, we had a focus on human rights. Remember the sentence says, every human being is born equal in dignity and rights. During the past years, since 1948, the word dignity was forgotten a bit. Rights were focused. So we are speaking about human rights, even though this sentence speaks about dignity and rights. Why did we focus on rights first? It's a bit easier to define compared to dignity. For example, there are many other reasons. So I believe, you know, when we look at this, and now we live in a historic moment where we need to focus on dignity, not just on rights. Because rights can still be used to maintain duality in all systems. You know, I have a right, you are my enemy. Old system. So dignity creates the dialogue. So this is also very important for truth commissions. Truth is, the truth commission is following this spirit, it will be future oriented. If truth commissions follow, you know, focus on rights, they will be past oriented. So a truth commission can be very many things. So the word truth commission itself is empty. It depends on how, what it does. So if we think of our human family on this planet, if we think of the global challenges that we face, what is the minimum requirement we have to learn? The minimum requirement is to cooperate to solve our global challenges, even if we hate each other. We don't need to love. Many couples now divorce and they have shared custody for their children. So even if they hate each other, they still have shared responsibility for their children. This is the minimum requirement for us, the human family, on our planet. Even if we hate each other, we still have the responsibility to care about, be the stewards of our planet. This is the minimum requirement, and this is my first book about. We can also become a bit more ambitious, of course. This would mean doing more than simply avoiding humiliation. It would be healing humiliation of the past. You know, waging good conflict. This is the second book. You know, healing humiliation. And we can be very, very ambitious also. This would be to follow the example of Nelson Mandela. You remember that he was in prison for 27 years, and when he came out, some of his prison guards were his friends. So he turned enemies into friends. This is kind of maximum aim we can aim for as a human family on this planet. And these are my two gloves. So what do I decide to, how to see the world? I personally feel proud of all the achievements that we as a human family have accomplished. Like Rorodun. I'm very proud of Belgian chocolate, of Japanese aesthetics, of Norwegian indigenous food, of the pyramids. All the achievements that we as a human family have brought to this planet, I'm personally proud of it. And I personally feel responsible for all the suffering we have caused. I personally feel responsible for the suffering the dictatorship here has caused, Stalin has caused, Hitler has caused. I refrain from saying, this is your fault. I don't say that. It's my responsibility, it's our responsibility. If we want to create a future for our children that is dignified on this planet, we have to take responsibility for everything together. This is my personal question. And of course, I know it's a very idealized, and many people think it's a bit too difficult, but I think this is the step we have to go, because then we come get out of me, them, pointing fingers. And you remember the picture of the tsunami at the beginning. This is a picture of gloom and crisis. And you might want to get pessimistic and give up on our planet and give up on human family. And many people do. Many people say, we will die out, the dinosaurs made it for millions of years, we will make it for 100,000 years, and we will simply slowly now die out. And we need to enjoy our last days as good as we can. So this is one way to deal with the crisis. But I think there is one element that is new, and that opens an opportunity for real new thinking. And this is emblematic, this picture here is emblematic for that. This is the blue planet seen from the astronaut's perspective. And if you think about all the religious founders in the past, all the ideologists, all the philosophers in the past, our grandparents, could they see that? No. So this is an input that is profoundly new. And this is also why we carry so much responsibility that is new, because we are facing a situation that is new. You remember 10,000 years ago when people suddenly found that the next valley was taken by other people, they didn't know that the reason was that we are living on a globe that is living in size. They had no idea. They simply felt it indirectly. Today, we know exactly where we are. We exactly know we are a small family on a tiny, fragile planet in a huge universe. Not only do we know that, not only do we have an image now, we also have the technology to get together. We have internet now. All this, for example, we have travel. We can live globally, like I do live globally, and I do not want to invite you to live like me, but to manifest the reality that we are one family on a tiny planet, in all you do. As soon as we do that, you remember the past 10,000 years, everybody had to be afraid that the neighbor would become an enemy and take my land. As soon as we are really manifesting that we are one family on one planet, there is no outside enemy anymore, except from another galaxy. We only then have internal problems, but we don't have the old problem that some Vikings can come up the shores and take us. We don't have it anymore. Now we know the entire planet, we know every corner now. This is historically unique and gives us a window of opportunity to do a better adaptation. Your responsibility is, and my responsibility is, to use this window of opportunity and then not let it go by. As soon as we manifest this, that we are one family, then Gandhi's sentence can become reality. There is no path to peace. Peace is the path. You remember, the old motto was, if you want peace, prepare for war. Like 100 years ago, you would be talking about peace, you would, especially in a war, you would be a traitor. You would be unpatriotic. Today, as soon as we define ourselves as one family and there's no outside enemy anymore, this sentence can be realized. And you remember that we were talking before that some people still stay in the old world. You know, the fear of the neighbor taking my land is called security dilemma in political science. And we see still some people trying to keep the security dilemma artificially alive. The Cold War ended and suddenly there was no outside enemy anymore. You remember what happened when the Iraq War was declared. There was the figment of an enemy, you know, as if we needed an enemy because we couldn't live without an enemy. So it was a continuation of the security dilemma while it had already been gone. So today we need to somehow manifest this, that we are one family where we don't have to be afraid of an enemy, an outside enemy anymore. So then, as soon as we do that, this sentence here can really live. It has a chance. As I said, in the past 10,000 years, religious founders always tried that. But they couldn't, because it was always then taken up by hierarchy again. Never lived long. I think now we have a chance to really make it live long. Dignity. Our dear Francisco, he sent me this email. And he said, dignity has three aspects. It speaks to the human character, it speaks to mutual respect, and it speaks about communicative dignity. He is the master of communicative dignity. And I told you that we launched the World Dignity University Initiative last year, and we did that in Norway. And he sent us this communicative dignity checklist as a PDF file, and we printed it out and we put it in all the tables during the launch of our World Dignity University Initiative, and many people read it and enjoyed it very, very much. So you have the privilege of getting this now here. So you see, these three elements have been somehow mirrored in many cultures. We have one member in our network, Victoria Fontan. She did research in Iraq. So she wrote, honor in Iraq can be described in three words, sharaf, ihtiram, and ilm. Sharaf is honor bestowed on a man whose service or lineage are found deserving by his peer. Ihtiram is the honor he can gain by imposing himself on others by force. Ilm is the honor measured as his success in protecting his women from intruders. Sharaf is given to a man, he can only invite it through benevolent action. While ihtiram and ilm depend on his ability to impose his will on his environment. Together, these three elements describe the standing a man can claim to have in social function. Women are his substrate. So you remember these three elements of dignity, you see? So if you read the definitions of honor and standing in Iraq, and you put them in here, you get two triangles. You remember that I said before that peace, reconciliation, love, happiness, they have all very, very different definitions in each of these two paradigms. The same is the case here. Like what you read about Iraq just now, it is the description of an honor society, a ranked society, where worthiness is ranked. And the word dignity comes from a word that was also regarding rank. Dignitarians are people who are higher. So even the word dignity comes from the ranked past. And what does it mean? You know, a human character in the ranked system means a mutual respect and communicated honor. They mean, for a woman, for example, a woman would have a very highly developed character, and she would express respect if she accepts being beaten quietly. So this would be communicated honor for her, to know her place, and her husband the same. Yes. So you see that all these terms mean something completely different here in this room, I think. You know, human character now means that men and women learn to live in dialogue, not anymore in hierarchy, but in dialogue as equals. This would be a human character of high sophistication. And mutual respect would not mean anymore that you know your lowly place or your high place, but that you know your equal place. And communicative dignity would be to learn how to communicate between equals. Because here it's much easier to give orders than to receive orders. Obedience is a much easier communicative strategy than dialogue. So all of us here, we have been socialized more or less into that. And we have, none of us has really learned the sophistication and complications of dialogue. And I'm impressed. Here in Brazil, I must admit that I have found few places on this planet who have such a high degree of skill in dialogue. And, you know, reaching out is reaching out on an equal level. I have almost never seen such a high skill of doing this as I mean here in Brazil. So I really think, when you think about Brazil and what Brazil can give to the world, you might think of oil or of selling something valuable of natural resources. To me, the most important export article that Brazil has is the Brazilian skill I so far have observed of connecting to other people, reaching out. You might not know it because you are so used to it, but it's extraordinary. I really enjoy being here because I'm surrounded by people who reach out, and this is just amazing. So I really, really beg you to know that this is a resource that is very, very needs to be nurtured. The world needs this resource. Please, you need to help the United States. This here is an American institution. The United States needs your help. You might think that you are looking to the United States for their example or more model. No. The United States needs to look up to you as a model. So you are perhaps the developed world in that case, in that respect. Many other parts of the world are the developing world that call themselves developed. Because they are still in this moment. So what is important? This culture of connectivity that Brazil has is hugely important for humankind to learn if we want to survive in a dignified way on this planet. What we also have to look to think about is what I said earlier. 10,000 years ago, we learned intensification. This means taking more, looking where are more resources that I can take. The colonial masses were people like that. They looked around on this planet, and here they saw some continents to grab, and they grabbed them. Then came the industrial man, another way of grabbing, an intensification, you know, getting more out of something. Now we have the shareholder. Like today, we have legal frame. This is the legal frame. Like we have laws that would compel the head of a company, the CEO of a company, to maximize profit for the shareholders. The shareholders sue the CEO of the company if the CEO also considers social and ecological aspects in his decision making, not just profit maximization. So if you leave our legal frame we have now, basically the legal frame of what Immanuel Wallerstein calls the world system is today built on the Roman law. If we look back, what is the legal frame of our institutions, global institutions, IMF, World Bank, etc.? Then they come originally from Roman law. And Roman law is a legalized, is a way to legalize what we learned as a human family 10,000 years ago, namely intensification. It makes it more legal to do that. So this is the frame we have now. And many who sit here, they know, and Rio plus 20 shows us, to simply live for profit maximization, to put that first as a priority everywhere in our society, is not sustainable. We need to also take social and ecological considerations into the country. So many people who are here, they are part of a grassroots projects that bring more dignity into the world than simply profit. Many CEOs also would like to do that. But at the moment, I see everywhere in the world there are so many grassroots projects and initiatives. They normally start by sitting down, making a business plan, getting funding, employing people to do the projects, and when the funding is ending, the project is ending. And often the funding is ending when the project gets successful. So at the moment I see that everywhere where I go, people who want to do more than just serve shareholder value, who want also to be share givers and careholders and stakeholders, people who want to be bigger than that, they are cut short at some point by this frame. So therefore I live globally because I want to contribute to that, you know, the thinking. We as a human family need to sit down and to think, what would be better frames? We need to enlarge these frames. How would they have to look like? This is our task, to sit together and to think about that. Our job is not to give people fish. This is what social entrepreneur William Drayton said about social entrepreneurship. You all have heard that, I'm sure. Our job is not to give people fish. It is not to teach them how to fish. It is to build a new and better fishing industry. And today we have to go further. What if the oceans are empty? What if the oceans are overfished? Then building a better fishing industry would be disastrous. So, you know, we cannot teach people to fish when there is no fish. Or, you know, so this, we need to extend this sentence. You know, we need to build a new, better, global way of living on this planet together. And why do we have problems doing that today? Why do we have problems? Because of humiliation. One reason. You remember Rwanda. Why did not the 5,000, you know, the UN troops that were in Rwanda stationed in 1994, when the genocide started, when the people started killing, why did not the UN troops stop it? Do you know that? You know, they were, people say 5,000 soldiers could have stopped and could have stopped the killing and could have saved 1 million lives. 5,000 soldiers. Why were they not sent? On the contrary, the UN took their forces out of the country and left the people to be killed. Why? Because of humiliation. Just not long before, the United States, the UN and the United States, try to help Somalia. You have perhaps seen the film Black Hawk Down.
Mm-hmm.
So they try to help Somalia, and And what was the result of this wanting to help? I'm not sure, some might remember that. There was an American pilot being shot down over Mogadishu, Somalia. And his naked body was pulled through the streets of Mogadishu. This was the humiliation of the United States. And the United States pulled out of Somalia. When the killing in Rwanda started, why was there no help? The argument was, we do not want a second Somalia. We were wanting to help, we reaped humiliation. If we help here, we might reap humiliation again. Recent experience that help led to humiliation hindered help for one. So you see that experience of humiliation make people stop in their track. They are emotional obstacles sometimes. At the moment, we see the same thing, the outfall of the Cold War. I think you are perhaps the only American sitting here has grown up in America, I'm not sure. So you know the atmosphere is still there, how difficult it was to be in the Cold War, and how the Cold War really made a split in the world and in the psyches of people. There were the humiliators were the Soviet Union, and we were the good ones. And of course in the Soviet Union, the opposite was the ideology. And it was a kind of competition in who can humiliate whom more. Like in Afghanistan, it was Kissinger, I think he said, the Russians want to humiliate us by going into Afghanistan and we have to humiliate them. So it was a competition and who can humiliate whom more and who can win in that cycle of humiliation. So there was a cycle of humiliation that caught the whole world. And the South American dictatorships are just an outfall of that. Because as we saw demonstrated before, in dualism, when in humiliation, cycles of humiliation, as we said, they create that. In dualism, you have one group who wants all their followers to follow obediently, and the other group the same. So we had basically two dictatorial systems, and we have still North Korea as a remnant. So we had two dictatorial systems caught in a cycle of humiliation, and the dictatorships here were an outfall of that. And today, I think the global economy is a victim of that. Why? Because we are caught in the fact that words like communism, socialism, capitalism are part of this cycle, these cycles of humiliation. They are still kind of remnants of this Cold War. And we don't look at them as what they are, but we are caught in our feelings of humiliation. And the discussion about economy is handled by these feelings. So wherever I go, like when I'm in certain audiences in the United States, I should not even utter the word socialism or communism in a certain audience. I would be thrown out. I just gave a talk in Chile. It was the 79th anniversary of the founding of the Socialist Party. There, I would be thrown out if I would, speak highly of the free market or capitalism. I would be thrown out there. So these words, simply the word, are so loaded that people don't even know anymore what it means. Nobody has really read Adam Smith. Normally he's completely misread now. Okay, so Brazil's strength. I think what Brazil has is your amazing family cohesion. Eduardo Carvalho, when we are sitting together with lunch, Monica, he told me about, told us about the strength of the family relations here in Recife, that people don't leave Recife because you're used to living families here, in tight families. And this is your asset. This is an asset. And the only thing I beg you to do is to expand this sense of family into the entire human family. I invite you to do it. happened before. Here we have communism, like this would be North Korea, and you know, I know very well the story of East Germany, and I know that these systems are simply horrifying. You know, they keep people in a kind of slavery. So you have here, and it's always the dominator society. You see that? Here's the leader, and then there are the masses. And this is Morumbi in Sao Paulo. You see, it's very similar. Here are the rich, and here are the masses. So far, we as a human family, we have not yet managed to build a world of equality in dignity, where people have living conditions that make it possible for them to be equal in dignity. We have not succeeded. Just now, the last years, the inequality everywhere, locally and globally, has increased. The gap between rich and poor has increased dramatically. This is the biggest social problem just now. So here we have it, and here we have it. So should we now, be fighting about who humiliates whom better? No. This would be, to me, to be stuck in the past, stuck in cycles of humiliation of the past, and pay the price for cycles of humiliation of the past. We have to free ourselves of that. And therefore, I coined the word dignism, from dignity. Let us forget about communism, capitalism, let us think of dignity. What would make give our children a dignified world to live in? What? Dignity. What does it mean, dignity? One explanation or one manifestation would be the dialogue. You remember the infinity symbol. And this infinity symbol, or the symbol for dialogue, would be also explained or expanded on by the motto or the principle of unity in diversity. Dignity is operationalized if we think of unity in diversity. Here we have uniformity without diversity. You see that? And here we have uniformity without diversity. Here we have also division instead of unity. Here also we have division instead of unity. We never have unity in diversity. And between them we have division instead of unity. So we always, when we see our world today, we never manifest so far unity in diversity. We always manifest uniformity without diversity and division without unity. So unity in diversity, it means sitting together like we sit here, and perhaps even on the floor, because the chairs are an invention of the ranked past. They are not good for our health. For the dignity of our body, it's not good to sit on chairs. So, sitting on the floor, sitting together, finding new ways of finding consensus. It's not enough to call, to say we need elections. This is not enough of democracy. Democracy today needs to be developed much further. We need to think of other ways, of better ways of consensus building. And we have a lot of indigenous knowledge there to harvest from. This is a palaver or a ho'oponopono in Hawaii, or a shir or a loa jerga. There are many, many words in many, many indigenous societies for that. And Ubuntu philosophy in Africa. So, dignism is the word I have coined. And what is unity in diversity? I think Gabi gave me this. Gabi gave me this quote from Boaventura de Sousa Santos. He has a wonderful explanation of what unity in diversity is. He said, we have the right to be equal whenever difference diminishes us. We have the right to be different whenever equality de-characterizes us. I think this is a great gift from Brazil to the world, explaining unity in diversity. So we need to move from globally and locally, from closed to open society. John Dewey, you know, since we here are in an American context, Brazilian-American context, John Dewey, a great American philosopher, he speaks of an experimental society. democratic and scientifically rational ethical regime. That was their position. And you see that all this now is not really happening due to us clinging to cycles of humiliation of the past. These emotions hinder us to simply see what would work. Okay, if our children should find a planet worth living on, what should we do? No, we are not. We are caught in circles of humiliation of the past, and therefore we cannot really think freely. So we need to free ourselves from that. What do we need for that? And this is now almost the last slide. After that, we were almost at the end of this session together. And then we can engage in dialogue together. So what do we need? Courage. You know, I personally need a lot of courage. Where will I be in 2014? I think some people here would say to me, and some people do say to me, you know, I cannot live like that. I would need to have a house where I can go, where I have a key. No? So I need a lot of courage to live the life I live. You know, I needed to know that, you know, Francisco will take care of me when I'm in my season, and he did. Mm-hmm. No? So, curiosity. I'm curious, you know, I was curious when I, for the first time, saw your dosa de cajou. Or, you know, the your rodo. You see, I'm curious, and I always ask when we are going to lunch, what is the Brazilian food here? So I'm curious. Then awe and wonderment. This is difficult to translate. I've learned maravillamente means like that we stand in front of the universe that is so large that we don't understand it. And that we know that we are too small to make dogmas and say, oh, God is blue or God is yellow. No, we don't know. We are so small, and the universe is so big, and we can basically say that stand there only in awe and wonderment and humility. Humility means to be aware that we are very small. And to be patient. Patient enough and hasty enough in certain situations. Walking the talk. Walking the talk means, you know, I usually say that when I describe the network I'm developing globally, the community. Then I would say, who is it I invite in this network? I invite the people who walk their talk. This means when I meet people who make it very, very simplified, give lectures about human rights and then go home and meet their wives. I would not invite that person. Of course, nobody's perfect. Nobody's perfect, but at least I think it's important to reflect on our own lives and how we manifest our own values in our own lives. Then swimming versus clinging. If we think of a river, and we are in a river, and I think more and more our world is an interdependent world, and it, you know, life is the river. First reaction, or the first tendency to want to have safety in the river might be to want to cling to something fixed. And this is what many societies have tried. And therefore also rights can be used for that. To make something fixed and secure. And I should have to know in 2014, I should know that I have a house, I have a key, that I can go to a house that is fixed. I think real safety is to learn to swim. This is real safety. But it's more difficult than clinging. So it needs a skill. And this is again why I so much admire your way of connecting here, because it makes it much easier for people to learn to swim. Then humiliation awareness, as we have talked, you know, the strength of feeling of humiliation, strength of these feelings, how they can be used to really lead to mayhem, to terrible things. How these feelings hamper, you know, us, you know, limit people. Follow our prayers, call for consent is our son. If we want that, then we need this force of these feelings of humiliation as well. So, and the most important thing is love. Not the love between man and woman, man and woman necessarily, but the love in society. I have decided I love the human family unconditionally. Whatever happens, I love and I give my love. I dedicate my entire life to this. I was so touched what your father told you. The last sentence your father told you was, "We are here to serve." This is the expression of this love. And this is what really defines me. This love to the human family and my dedication to serve. So I dedicate every single minute. I work day and night. And I don't do it because I have a job. I don't do it because I get paid. I do it because I need to serve. I feel also very satisfied, very fulfilled. My life is very meaningful. I never have a depressed night, I never feel bored, I never need vacation because I don't need vacation from my vision. So love is the most important thing, and I think here you have so much love. For example, when I come here to Gaba, there is so much love, I'm just blown away. This is wonderful. So now I call for a global movement of citizens to build institutions that end practices of humiliation and enable equality and dignity globally as a frame for equal dignity also globally. And this question mark signifies that my experience tells me that after my presentation, there are always normally one or two people who come to me and who are very angry at me. Something I said has humiliated them without me wanting it. So I would like to preventively apologize if I have lesser beings. You know, and the people, the passengers, do not need to look up to the boss and regard them as higher beings, the pilots as higher beings. So there, this comes in, the higher beings and low beings. And in the past 10,000 years, this has been done. Like somebody who sweeps the street, who has a lowly job, would also be a lowly person. It would be essentialized. The lowliness of the task would be, you know, translated into the essence of his worthiness. He would be worthless as a human being. So we, when we speak about equality, dignity, we somehow take this essentialization out of the equation. We say everybody is equal. The person who sweeps the street, and or the people who are mentally handicapped and can do nothing, whatever, well, mentally, you know, have some difference. They are equally worthy as human beings. And the hierarchy, the functional hierarchies that we need are somehow not touched by that. However, there is a kind of connection there. We cannot now not simply say, okay, then we can simply accept the world as it is. All the poor people, they are poor, and all the rich people are rich, and everybody's equal in dignity. It's a bit too short. We would have to go one step further and say, look, you know, is it really a dignifying way we arrange our human affairs on this planet, so that we end up with so many people having no access to clean water and living in undignified lives? Is this really a dignified setup of our way we live on this planet? So there we would come into equality, you know, equal conditions of life. So there is this slight connection there. But in the beginning, you know, like if you simplify it really, you could keep these two things completely different apart, like equality, you know, hierarchy could very, very well live together with equality in the world. So to just, I think there's often a confusion there, that people who speak about equality and dignity think that equality is the same, but it's not.
Mm-hmm. To some extent, that was my point. I mean, yeah. There still is a need to a certain acknowledgement of hierarchy.
Like the plane will fall down, otherwise, yes, this is the need, yeah. Absolutely.
And the younger, I think the younger the age, the greater the need for this acknowledgement. Because the age, you know, they don't see the world as they will see one day as they grow up and they become adults and have a better quote, perspective.
It depends, of course, if the parents understand this concept. If the parents don't understand this concept, it's not such a, you know, I just saw your nephew showed me this wonderful film, Beecher's Dog, no, this young man who has one marijuana joint, it falls down, the father thinks he's a, father sends him into a
psychiatrist.
Yeah. You have seen this film, this young man, how he then
ends. He said, puts him in a, institution.
Right, and how he ends in this institution. So there you have a father who somehow is not a good pilot, you would say. He crashes his son, yeah, his son's life.
I was there.
You want the story twice.
Yeah, sure.
it's important to share.
You know, the Norway is far away and poor until 1962 when oil was found. It was so poor, half of Norway is in the United States, in Michigan, and so it's Norwegian because it was so poor. And so the Norway of today is a very new thing. So it was so poor and so far away that nobody wanted to conquer. You remember we were talking about that everybody had to be afraid of their neighbors, but so